The Last Stalinist, Santiago Carrillo, 1915-2012, written by Paul Preston, read by Jonathan Keeble. Preface. This is the complex story of a man of great importance. From 1939 to 1975, the Spanish Communist Party, the Partido Comunista de España, or PCE, was the most determined opponent of the Franco regime. As its effective leader for two decades, Santiago Carrillo was arguably the dictator's most consistent left-wing enemy. Whether Franco was concerned about the left-wing opposition is another question. However, the lack of a comparable figure in either the anarchist or socialist movements means that the title belongs indisputably to Carrillo. Carrillo's was a life of markedly different and apparently contradictory phases. In the first half of his political career, in Spain and in exile, from the mid-1930s to the mid-1970s, Santiago Carrillo was admired by many on the left as a revolutionary and a pillar of the anti-Franco struggle, and hated by others as a Stalinist gravedigger of the revolution. For many on the right, he was a monster to be vilified as a mass murderer for his activities during the Civil War. He came to prominence as a hot-headed leader of the socialist youth, whose incendiary rhetoric contributed in no small measure to the revolutionary events of October 1934. After 16 months in prison, he abandoned and betrayed the Socialist Party by taking its youth movement into the Communist Party. This dowry and his unquestioning loyalty to Moscow were rewarded during the Civil War by rapid promotion within the communist ranks. Not yet 22 years old, he became public order chief in the besieged Spanish capital and acquired enduring notoriety for his alleged role in the episodes known collectively as Paracelsus, the elimination of right-wing prisoners. After the war, he was a faithful apparatchik, who, by dint of skill and ruthless ambition, rose to the leadership of the Communist Party. Then, in the course of the second half of his political career, from the mid-1970s until his death in 2012, he came to be seen as a national treasure because of his contribution to the restoration of democracy. From his return to Spain in 1976 until 1981, his skills, honed in the internal power struggles of the PCE, were applied in the national political arena. During the early years of the transition, it appeared as if the interests of the PCE coincided with those of the population. He would be canonized as a crucial pillar of Spanish democracy as a result of his moderation then. He was particularly lauded for his bravery on the night of the 23rd of February 1981, when the Spanish Parliament was seized as part of a failed military coup. After that time, his role reverted to that of party leader, and he was undone by generational conflict. Between 1981 and 1985, he presided over the destruction of the Communist Party, which he had spent 40 years shaping in his own image. Accordingly, in later life and on his death, he was the object of many tributes and accolades from members of the Spanish establishment, ranging from the king to right-wing heavyweights. The checkered nature of Carrillo's political career poses the question of whether he was simply a cynical and clever chameleon. In 1974, denying the existence of a personality cult within the PCE, he proclaimed, "I will never permit propaganda being made about myself." Then, in an interview given 2 years later, he announced, "I will never write my memoirs, because a politician cannot tell the truth." He had already contradicted the first of these denials by dint of speeches and internal party reports, in which he constructed the myth of a selfless fighter for democracy. Then, in his last 4 decades, he propagated numerous accounts of his life in countless interviews, in more than 10 of the many books that he wrote himself, and in 2 others that he dictated. In this regard, he shared with Franco a dedication to the constant rewriting and improving of his own life story. Accordingly, this account of a fascinating life differs significantly from the many versions produced by the man himself, which are contrasted here with copious documentation and the interpretations of friends and enemies. There can be little here about Carrillo's personal life. From the time that he entered employment at the printing works of the Socialist Party, aged 13, until his retirement from active politics in 1991, he seems not to have had much of one. Certainly, his life was dominated by his political activity, but he surrounded accounts about his existence outside politics with a web of contradictory statements and downright untruth. Despite his apparent gregariousness and loquacity, this is the story of a solitary man. One by one, he turned on those who helped him. Lago Caballero, his father, Venceslao Carrillo, Segundo Serrano Poncela, Francisco Anton, Fernando Claudin, Jorge Semprún, Pilar Bravo, Manuel Azcarate, Ignacio Gallego. The list is very long. In his anxiety for advancement, he was always ready to betray or denounce comrades. Such ruthlessness was another characteristic that he shared with Franco. What would become clear is that Carrillo had certain qualities in abundance: a capacity for hard work, stamina and endurance, writing and oratorical skills, intelligence and cunning. Unfortunately, what will become equally clear is that honesty and loyalty were not among them. Chapter 1. The Creation of a Revolutionary, 1915 to 1934. Santiago Carrillo was born on the 18th of January 1915 to a working-class family in Gijón, on Spain's northern coast. His grandfather, his father, and his uncles all earned their living as metal workers in the Orueta factory. Prior to her marriage, his mother, Rosalia Solares, was a seamstress. His father, Venceslao Carrillo, was a prominent trade unionist and member of the Socialist Party, who made every effort to help his son follow in his footsteps. As secretary of the Asturian Metalworkers Union, Venceslao had been imprisoned after the revolutionary strike of August 1917. Indeed, Santiago claimed later that his most profound memory of his father was seeing him regularly being taken away by civil guards from the family home. It was there, and later in Madrid, that he grew up within a warm and affectionate extended family, in an atmosphere soaked in a sense of the class struggle. Such a childhood would help account for the impregnable self-confidence that was always to underlie his career. He asserted in his memoirs that family was always tremendously important to him. That, however, would not account for the viciousness with which he renounced his father in 1939. Then, as throughout his life, at least until his withdrawal from the Communist Party in the mid-1980s, political loyalties and ambition would count for far more than family. Santiago was one of seven children, two of whom died very young. His brother, Roberto, died during a smallpox epidemic in Gijón, but Santiago managed to survive unscathed thanks to the efforts of his paternal grandmother, who slept in the same bed to stop him scratching his spots. A younger sister, Margarita, died of meningitis only 2 months after being born. A brother born subsequently was also named Roberto. Coming from a left-wing family, Santiago was not short of rebellious tendencies, and, perhaps inevitably, they were exacerbated when he attended Catholic primary school. By then, the family had moved to Aviles, 12 miles west of Gijón. For an inadvertent blasphemy, he was obliged to spend an hour kneeling with his arms stretched out in the form of a cross while holding extremely heavy books in each hand. In reaction to the bigotry of his teachers, his parents took him out of the school. Shortly afterwards, the local workers' centre opened, in the attic of its headquarters, a small school for the children of trade union members. A non-religious teacher was difficult to find, and the task fell to a hunchbacked municipal street sweeper, who happened to be slightly more cultured than most of his comrades. Carrillo later remembered with regret the cruel mockery to which he and his fellow urchins subjected the poor man. Not long afterwards, in early 1924, with Wenceslao, now both a full-time trade union official of the General Union of Workers, Union General de Trabajadores, and writing for El Socialista, the newspaper of the Socialist Party, Partido Socialista Obrero Español, or PSOE, the family moved to Madrid. There, on the exiguous salary that the UGT could afford to pay Wenceslao, they lived in a variety of poor working-class districts. At first, they endured appalling conditions, and Santiago later recalled that he witnessed suicides and crimes of passion. In the barrio of Cuatro Caminos, he had the good luck to gain entry to an excellent school, the Grupo Escolar Cervantes. He later attributed to its committed teachers and its 12-hour school day enormous influence in his development, in particular his indubitable work ethic. Whatever criticisms might be made of Carrillo, an accusation of laziness would never be one of them. He was also toughened up by the constant fistfights with a variety of school bullies. As a 13-year-old, his ambition was to be an engineer. However, neither the school nor his family could afford the cost of the examination entry fee for each of the 6 subjects of the school leaving certificate. Accordingly, without being able to pursue further studies, he left school with a burning sense of social injustice. Thanks to his father, he would soon embark on a meteoric rise within the socialist movement. Wenceslao managed to get him a job at the printing works of El Socialista, La Gráfica Socialista. This required him to join the UGT and the socialist youth movement, Federación de Juventudes Socialistas. As early as November 1929, the ambitious young Santiago, not yet 15 years of age, published his first articles in Aurora Social of Oviedo, calling for the creation of a student section of the FJS. Helped by the position of his father, he enjoyed a remarkably rapid rise within the FJS, almost immediately being voted onto its executive committee. Of key importance in this respect was the patronage that derived from Wenceslao Carrillo's close friendship with the hugely influential union leader Francisco Largo Caballero. An austere figure in public life, Largo Caballero was affectionately known as Don Paco in the Carrillo household. The two families used to meet socially for weekly picnics in Dehesa de la Villa, a park outside Madrid. Along with the food and wine, they used to bring a small barrel organ, organillo. It was used to accompany Don Paco and his wife, Concha, as they showed off their skill in the typical Madrid dance, the chotis. This family connection was to constitute a massive boost to Santiago's career within the PSOE. Indeed, the veteran leader had often given the baby Santiago his bottle and felt a paternalistic affection for him that would persist until the Civil War. Later, when he was old enough to understand, Santiago would avidly listen to the conversations of his father and Largo Caballero about the internal disputes within both the UGT and PSOE. There can be little doubt that the utterly pragmatic and hardly ideological stances of these two hardened union bureaucrats were to be a deep influence on Santiago's own political development. Their tendency to personalize union conflicts would also be reflected in his own later conduct of polemics in both the socialist and communist parties. Santiago was soon publishing regularly in Renovación, the weekly news sheet of the FJS. This brought him into frequent contact with his almost exact contemporary, the famous intellectual prodigy Hildegard Rodriguez, who, as a teenager, was already giving lectures and writing articles on sexual politics and eugenics. She spoke 6 languages by the age of 8 and would have a law degree at the age of 17. Just as she was rising to prominence within the socialist youth, she was shot dead by her mother, Aurora, jealous of Hildegard's growing independence. In early 1930, the editor of El Socialista, Andrés Saborit, offered Santiago the chance to leave the machinery of the printing works and work full-time in the paper's editorial offices. It was a promotion that suggested the hands of his father and Don Paco. He started off modestly enough, cutting and pasting agency items and then writing headlines for them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.